ऑफ एसयूबी एसवीपी हॉस्पिटल अहमदाबाद, प्रेजेंटिंग केस ऑफ मिस्टर एक्स, 55 ईयर ओल्ड हिंदू मेल पेशेंट, लेबरर रिसाइडिंग एट बापू नगर अहमदाबाद, बिलोंगिंग टू द लोअर सोशो इकोनॉमिकल क्लास, केम टू एसवीपी हॉस्पिटल ओपीडी विथ चीफ कंप्लेन ऑफ ब्लड इन वॉमिटर्स 3 एपिसोड इन लास्ट 3 ईयर्स, ब्लैक टारी स्कूल फॉर लास्ट 1 वीक. Origin, duration and progress. Patient was relatively asymptomatic before 3 years when he had bought of blood of approx 250 cc, fresh blood, non-containing food particle, non-associated with nausea, and he went for endoscopic injection therapy at that time. Then he had the similar episode a year back. For that again he went for endoscopic ring therapy and 2 pints of the blood transfusion given. Third episode is one day back, which is profuse, rapid, and approx of 200 ml of fresh blood, non-projectile and non-containing food particles. He also complained of gradual abdominal distension in last 6 months. Is not associated with meal. Mild abdominal discomfort present for the last 1 month. He also had bilateral lower limb swelling up to the
discussion
ankle for last
all over
1 month.
India.
Patient had complained of black tarry stool for last 1 week, non-salt swelling,
Independent hour.
non-associated with diarrhea. No history of fever, yellowish discoloration of urine, chronic use of
Huh?
drug for any pain or mental illness. No history of anorexia or weight loss. Past history. Patient is a known case of hypertension for last 15 years, taking medicine regularly. No history of diabetes or tuberculosis. No past operative history. No past history of a jaundice. He is on some medication for last 3 years for rheumatism, which frequency of the same tablet is increased in last 6 months. There is no significant family history. Personal history. Patient diet is a mix. Patient was advised to have salt restricted diet from last 1 year. Sleep pattern is not altered. Normal bladder habit. Other than a black tarry stool, bladder ha bowel habit is a normal. He took alcohol for last 20 years. Country liquor of approx 200 ml once or twice daily. History of smoking last 20 years, 2 to 3 bidis in a day. Should I proceed, sir?
May you please wait, let the faculty
Okay.
ask Dr. Hemant, Dr. Shanti ma'am for the
Oh, give a summary.
55-year-old male, alcoholic, come to the com come with a complaint of hematemesis, 3 episodes in last 3 years, and black tarry stool for last 1 week. He also has a complaint of gradual abdominal distension from last 6 months. He is on some medication for hematemesis in last 3 years. This is a known case of hypertension, and there is no significant jaundice, any jaundice or the operative history.
Can you go to the last slide?
Yes.
Go to the last slide. No.
First.
Yeah, this one. Yeah, this one. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, the next one.
Next one is history of presenting illness. Yeah. What
Now
is
count
it?
how many lines are there.
Yeah.
Just count how many lines are there. I counted it 17 lines are there. Is that correct?
15 lines, sir. Yes, sir.
So do you think it is a good way to make a slide? You must have seen for so many months we are, the students are preparing the slides. What is the rule for that?
Yes.
How do you make the slide? A basic rule for that, yeah. One slide should not contain more than 6 lines and 6 words only, okay? That is a standard thing which is there, right? So when you make a slide from the next time, take care of that, you know?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is not only for the clinical purpose. It is also whenever you are presenting something, you must know how to make the slides, you know?
Okay.
And what is this ODP?
Origin, duration, and progress, sir.
Hmm?
Origin, duration, and progress, sir.
Origin.
Origin.
Duration and progress, sir. How it appear, how it progress, sir.
We call it as history of presenting illness. Yeah, ODP is a new
who has
term.
Given this word to you? because I am hearing it for the first time, you know.
First time, yeah.
I am hearing it for the first time.
Unusual.
Pratik, nowadays with the mobile and all these things, you people are using a lot of all these kind of words.
Yeah, Pratik,
please do not use. It should be internationally accepted. Then only you use that words, right?
Okay.
OTP, I remembered a OTP. So OTP.
I think it was, you know, I thought probably it is OTP, you know, one time password is coming to you. Okay, Pratik, tell what, how will you differentiate whether the patient is having the hematemesis or hemoptysis?
Sir, there is no history of a cough. It is approx 200 profuse painless blood. Sir, if it is hemoptysis, there is cough is present and the amount is little less, sir. And it is associated with the cough.
Mm-hmm. And what is the color?
Color is sir, little darker in the sir, hemoptysis. And sir, it is fresh blood in hemoptysis.
It is dark in?
Hemoptysis, sir. It is mucus. It is with cough, sir.
No, which one is blackish or darkish? Is it hemoptysis or hematemesis?
Hematemesis, sir, is darker, sir.
Yes. And what does the hemoptysis contain? That blood, what does it contain?
Sir, cough, sir. Productive cough.
And what can you see in that blood which is there?
Sir, clot.
Hmm?
Clot, sir.
Clot. What is clot?
Clotting.
Clot. Clot will occur in the hemoptysis?
Hemoptysis.
Or hematemesis?
Sir, if it is due to the sir, peptic ulcer disease, sir, it is with, sir, clot is present in hematemesis. Sir.
In hematemesis, no? In hemoptysis, it is not clot. It is a fresh blood.
Yes.
And it contains a froth. Okay, the air bubbles in that. You know, it will be much reddish in color as compared to the blackish color of the hematemesis. What is the difference in the pH of the, if you do the pH of that blood, what will be the difference?
Sir, hematemesis blood is sir, more acidic, sir. While hemoptysis is alkali, sir.
Okay.
And regarding the vomiting, you have made it as non-projectile, not getting food particles alone. Anything else you have to add in that?
Sir, retching, sir, ma'am.
Retching.
Yes.
You have to add whether it is bilious, non-bilious also, no, along with blood. You are not containing food particles.
Yes, cells, not containing food particles.
Food particles. Whether induced or it is spontaneous regarding vomiting, all this should be added, I think, along with this. Okay. Abdominal distance.
Dr. Pratik.
Yes, sir.
Why not it is Mallory-Weiss syndrome?
Sir, there is in Mallory-Weiss syndrome, there is a first is sir, retching and these are forceful vomiting is present, sir. In this case, sir, it is spontaneous spontaneous vomiting and in first episode, it is fresh blood, sir.
So, what you should tell is, one is pain. There is actually severe pain is present. Second is, first vomitus is normal.
Yes,
then
sir.
Second vomitus contains a lot of blood, right?
Yes.
What is that due to? What is it due to? Can alcohol precipitate Mallory-Weiss syndrome?
No, sir.
No?
No. No.
Why not?
Sir, it is usually due to the sir, irritation when we do forceful vomiting against this closed glottis, sir.
My question to you is, can alcohol also precipitate Mallory-Weiss syndrome? It is yes. Okay. Not that only, that there are many causes are there. One of them is also alcohol. So I just want you to open up that in alcoholic patient, hematemesis is not only due to esophageal varices, but it can also be due to other causes, including peptic ulcer. Okay. Yes, that's all for me.
Pradeep, what is that third paragraph? Non-foul swelling or smelling?
Swelling, sir.
Huh?
Non-foul smelling. It is not
smelling. Smelling or swelling?
Sir, smell. Smelling, sir. Non-foul
smelling. Why is it put a swelling?
Sir, smelling.
Foul smelling. And you have patient has complaint. Okay.
Any chronic use of drug for pain and mental illness you have mentioned? No, what are the drugs? You can you tell some of the drugs which can produce hematemesis?
Sir, and ma'am, NSAIDs and TCS for mental illness.
For mental illness, anything alcohol along with any other drug can precipitate. For example, even paracetamol has got an effect on the toxicity, and it can also NSAIDs, alcohol, and any drugs for anti-tuberculous drugs also a patient may have been having, all these should be added. Okay. We should know what are the drugs to be asked. Okay. And any is the patient normal or is active? How is the activity? Whether he feels a little lethargic or normal as you before?
No, ma'am. He is normal as before.
Normal as before. Okay. Proceed. Next, go to the next slide.
Tell what are the causes of the non-foul smelling black colored stool?
Diverticulitis, sir. Large colon infection, sir.
Black colored stools. Tell the reasons of the black colored stool. And you say it is a non-foul smelling. Because if it is a melina is there, almost it has to be the foul smelling. So tell what are the other causes of the black colored stools.
Sir, any upper GI bleeding central into the sir black color stool, sir.
That is the GI bleed, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Apart from the other, that the black colored stool you said it's because of melina. I'm asking what are the other causes of the black colored stools? You know any drugs which can cause a black color stool?
No, sir.
You know any drug which was taken before, nowadays it is not, for the peptic ulcer, classically causing the black color stool?
It's a supplement, most probably.
It was used to be the for the treatment of the peptic ulcer, the bismuth.
Bismuth, yeah, sorry,
so
right.
So if you give the patient bismuth, it causes a black color. So you have to tell the patient that the patient will have the black color stool after that. Nowadays, it is not used, you know.
Even iron-containing tablets can produce.
Yeah, any iron-containing
tablet. Iron-containing tablet
can cause that. Yeah. Dr. Pratik, what should be the minimum amount of upper GI blood loss that will manifest as melina?
60 ml of blood, sir.
60 ml. And it may manifest for how many days?
Sir, after 3 to 5 days.
No. For how many days? After the episode of bleed, it is nearly up to 7 days. It may manifest as a black colored stool. Okay.
So, for causing melina, where should be the bleeding?
Sir, ma'am, it is usually before the ligament of Treitz, but it could be if transient time is fast, it could be a bleeding up to the transverse colon if present as the melina, ma'am.
Up to the transverse colon or up to the cecum?
Ma'am, usually it is in upper GI bleeding, but if transient time is fast, it could be up to the transverse colon.
Okay. So what is the cause for melina?
Different upper GI bleeding like peptic ulcer, hematemesis, gastritis, erosive gastritis could be present as melina.
Okay, proceed.
Pratik, you have written that he is on some medication for last 3 years.
Yes.
What do you think, what is that? What is, sir, your expectation in that?
It could be, sir, propanone also.
Okay.
Yeah, Pratik, one more question. Why the it is black in color? Melina is black in color. Upper GI bleed.
Sir, hemoglobin react with the sir acid and it convert into the heme, sir. Heme. So, sir, it is black terry color.
No. It's oxidation of the hemoglobin in the ileum and colon. That turns it into dark black color. Okay, otherwise the patient would also vomit a black color because acid-hematin reaction will take in the stomach itself. So ideally, the hematemesis should be, if it is not copious hematemesis, it should be black in color. Okay. So it is oxidation in the terminal ileum and the colon that makes it black in color.
The Pratik, can you tell me three important causes of a massive upper GI bleeding?
Sir, varices, esophageal or gastric. Sir, peptic ulcer, Mallory Weiss syndrome, sir.
Mallory Weiss, is it that common? Yes, it can give rise to massive erosive gastritis.
Yes, sir.
Right? What do you mean by acute hemorrhage? Acute.
Sir, patient. Oh.
Go ahead.
Sir, if patient present with the, without any alarm symptoms before, and spontaneous.
Not like that. Acute is the one which requires an admission. Patient requires a hospitalization for hypotension and shock. Okay. It's acute. Like you have acute hepatitis, acute pancreatitis, like that. Right?
Yes.
Okay.
How is alcohol going to affect? You have added alcohol, no? For the past 20 years, he has been taking. How is it going to have effect on the?
It leads to the alcoholic liver disease. Ma'am.
How does it affect the liver?
Fibrosis, sinusoidal fibrosis.
Initially, fibrosis or when the initial phase, what is happening?
Ma'am, initially there is a fatty liver changes, then it gradually progress to the cirrhosis. Ma'am.
Cirrhosis. First, initially there is a fatty change, followed by steatohepatitis, then followed by fibrosis. The nodule formation occurs. That's why portal obstruction occurs. No, so you should know the pathology behind the development of the hepatitis.
Pratik, your patient is a straightforward alcoholic, you have defined, and a patient who has got massive hematemesis. So, did you ask in the history any evidence of liver cell failure?
I did not ask, sir. I examined in general examination.
You should ask, right? What are the signs of liver cell failure or symptoms you need to ask?
Icterus, sir, cyanosis, clubbing, palmar erythema, gynecomastia, loss of axillary or pubic hair.
That is fine. So altered sensorium. Okay, altered sensorium. Okay.
You need a bad odor.
There's some disturbance is there, sound disturbance is there. What is this abdominal distension suggest?
Sir, ascites.
Abdominal distension suggests ascites. So you need to know, one is due to ascites. Can patient with the alcoholic cirrhosis or whatever can give rise to abdominal distension due to any other cause? I'll put it straight away. In the liver, can the distension be due to enlarged liver? What do you suspect?
Fatty changes, sir.
Cirrhosis means obviously it is shrunken liver. Such a liver is enlarged. What do you suspect?
It could be a malignancy, sir. HCC.
So abdominal, upper abdomen can be distended due to enlarged liver. Left side can also have a moderate splenomegaly and gross distension definitely due to ascites. Okay. This is how you try to analyze the case, right? Okay. Yeah. Did you ask about any hepatitis B, etc., etc.?
Yes, sir. I asked history for hepatitis, sir. Sir, history of jaundice, sir.
So all the risk factors should be inquired. Okay. Right.
You can add a bad breath also. He may have a foetal hepaticus,
yes.
No?
Yes.
So you should ask him that also should be added. Okay. Okay, proceed, Ma. Smoking, how is it related to? Is it important?
Ma'am, smoking is not related to the, for my case, ma'am. It's just for the general examination, sir. I ask patient.
No, smoking has got an added effect along with alcohol. It has also got an effect on the oxidative stress of the liver, no, because of the antioxidant produced. So it is not related, you cannot say. It's also related.
Okay.
Okay, go to the next.
With the examination now.
Examination, yeah. Next slide.
On a general examination, I examine patient under proper light and exposure. Patient is conscious, cooperative, and well oriented to the time, place, and person. Temperature is normal by palpation method. Pulse is 92 per minute in right radial artery. Blood pressure is 104 by 84 millimeter of mercury in right brachial artery. Respiratory rate is 18 per minute. BMI is 21.69. Pallor is present. Clubbing is present in the upper limb, male. Bilateral pitting edema up to the ankle is present. No evidence of cyanosis or lymphadenopathy. No evidence of palmar erythema, expressis, spinal devi, gynecomastia, or loss of axillary or pubic hair. On a local examination, on inspection, abdomen is distended, umbilical placed slightly inferiorly, and transversely stretched. Overlying skin appear normal, few stretch marks present over the abdomen, no dilated vein over the bilateral flank or umbilicus, no scar or pigmentation, hernial site appear normal, external genitalia appear normal. On a palpation, I have confirmed my inspectory finding on palpation. Temperature is normal, no tenderness over the abdomen. Abdomen is soft and distended, no guarding or rigidity. On a dipping matter, lump is palpable in the LHC and umbilical region up to the umbilicus. Move with respiration, form consistency, even surface with the palpable notch. Finger 10 cannot be incinerated between the swelling and the left costal margin. Not able to palpate the liver, bilateral testes palpate normally. On a percussion, horseshoe dullness and the shifting dullness present, which is continued with the splenic dullness. Splenic span is 12 cm. On a auscultation, peristalsis is present. Per rectal examination, black color stool present, grade 2 internal hemorrhoid at 7 o'clock present. No active bleeding is present. Wrist examination is normal. Systemic examination. On a respiratory system, bilateral air entry is equal up to the lower zone. CBS, S1, S4, no murmur. CNS patient is conscious and cooperative. Well oriented to time, place, and person. Provisional diagnosis. Ascites and hematemesis in a case of portal hypertension.
Can I go to the general examination slide? Yeah. So T, I thought it is TNM. You never use all these abbreviations. No, we've already told. Temperature, you can... T means by palpatory method. We don't know what it is. Don't use those abbreviations there. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
The pallor present, clubbing.
How did you see for clubbing?
For lobby bone angle, sir, ask patient to join his two thumb again each other. If lobby bone angle is alteration, there is clubbing is present. Ask patient to approximate his two thumbs of upper limb. If it is the diamond-ish form, then it is a normal. If it is altered, sir, it is clubbing is present, sir.
That is one way. What are the other ways to see for the clubbing?
Sir, check for a fluctuation in the nail bed, sir.
What else?
Sir, its appearance, sir, paropric appearance is present.
What else?
Osteoarthropathy, sir, present.
That is in the late form. Phase, no?
Yes, sir.
You like to see check? Can you see this angle here?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
Lobby bone angle, sir.
Yes, sir. That is the first thing you see there.
No? Yes, sir.
So there is the obliteration of that angle which is there. Right?
Have you checked ictus or not?
Yes, sir.
General examination.
No, sir. Ictus is not present, sir.
You do not mention.
Not ictus.
In this case, very important.
Up to the world.
Some signs of liver failure like tremors also should be seen, no? Flapping tremors can be there, and you can add how is the breath of the patient, whether bad breath is there. Those I think you have missed. Palmar erythema, asterisks, all these you have added. This is what are the signs of liver cell failure you have added, no? No evidence of all this. Anything else you have to add in this? Like fetal hepaticus, I already told. Any flapping tremors patient has got, you have to examine, add along with that. Okay.
No. How do you see for the flapping tremors?
What's
sir, ask patient to straight his hand and sir, there is flex, extend his palm, sir, and ask him to stay put straight, sir. Sir, ask patient to straight straight upper limb and then sir, extend his both palm and whether there is any tremor or not.
Pratik, I want you to, in addition to the liver cell failure and chronic hepatitis, I want to you to mention nutritional status of the patient in the examination, okay? Because this is the only one opportunity for you. Most of these patients, they have got very, very poor albumin, okay? So you need to look, at least you need to mention, you have mentioned pedal edema, but at least you should make a look the nutritional status. What are the ways you look for that?
Sir, BMI, sir. BMI, skin folding. Sir, gut at the tricep, sir.
What is that? What is it? What did you tell?
Skin fold thickening and the, sir, the girth, sir, diameter of the tricep, at the tricep level.
Tricep fold thickness.
Because
most of these patients have got hypoproteinemia.
Yes.
Okay. So that is one of the things which you need to mention. Right?
Yes.
What is spider nevi and what is De Morgan spots? Have you heard this word, De Morgan spots?
Yes, sir. Spider nevi is the cutaneous vasodilatation and red spot due to the cutaneous vasodilatation. Present, more overly present over the chest, center of the chest, and it is due to the present of the estrogen. A De Morgan spot is, sir, red spot. It is, sir, it is a cutaneous hemangioma.
What is that?
Cutaneous hemangioma, sir.
It's the sign of atherosclerosis.
Yes, sir.
They do not have those spider-like. Okay.
Yes.
So that is the difference. You need to carefully look when you are given a patient. Is there spider nevi or they are Campbell De Morgan spots? So in a, say we call it as a De Morgan spots. Okay. There are a few things you need to look for in the general examination. Did you mention about parotid enlargement? I don't know whether I missed. Mentioned?
No, sir.
You have to mention. You have to mention. Okay? Right. That's all for in the general examination.
What is the umbilical position? How can you differentiate if it is a female patient, for example, how to differentiate ascites under ovarian cyst or any other cystic lesion? How to differentiate?
Ma'am, in a female patient, if there is ovarian swelling is present, umbilicus moves up, move upward. Ma'am. In ascites, it move inferiorly. If its swelling is in the ovarian origin, the umbilicus is vertically stretched. While in the ascites, the umbilicus is transversely stretched.
On percussion, how to differentiate? On inspection, okay. How to in percussion? How to differentiate whether it is ovarian cyst or ascites?
Ma'am, shifting dullness, ma'am. In ascites, shifting dullness is present. While ma'am, in the ovarian cyst, ovarian swelling, there is no shifting dullness. Is present.
There may be ovarian swelling with ascites also, minimal ascites. How to differentiate?
Ma'am, palpation, any lump is palpable or not?
No. When you percuss, it will more centrally, if it is resonant, it is more for ascites because the fluid is displaced laterally and you also get shifting dullness and the bowel is in the central portion. So you get more resonance in the central, it is ascites. Whereas in ovarian cyst, centrally it is more dull and laterally in the flanks, it will be more resonant. Okay. And also position of the umbilicus. Both makes it different. Okay.
See, can you tell what are the various signs of ascites?
Abdominal distension, so transversely stretched abdomen, respiratory distress, and the umbilical hernia.
No. Signs of ascites.
Signs.
What are the various signs of ascites?
A puddle sign.
One is the shifting dullness, you said.
Yes, sir. Puddle sign, horseshoe dullness, shifting dullness, and fluid tree.
What is Daniel sign?
It is a shifting.
The shifting of umbilicus upwards in the pelvic mass.
Yes.
While in the case of ascites, it will go down. Jay. Oh,
that is Daniel sign.
And what is the smiling umbilicus?
Yes, transverse distant umbilicus.
Yes, so that is you find horizontal in the case of the ascites. And what is the Hamilton ruler test?
I don't know.
Okay, you can put a ruler in the lower part, and if you can sometimes get the transmitted pulsations, that is in fact called the Blaxland ruler test, which is there. Okay. So in the case of ovarian cyst, you know, because sometimes you have to differentiate between a big ovarian cyst and the ascites. So that is also one sign to differentiate. The transmitted pulsations can be appreciated in with the ruler test.
Okay.
Pratik.
Yes, sir.
What is the dilated vein you looked near the umbilicus?
Caput medius, superficial apical vein.
Don't only answer to the question. Say caput medius. That's all. Yes. Now I will ask you, what are the portal tributary and what are the systemic tributary involved in caput medius?
Okay. Sir, from portal system, it is umbilical vein, and there is a systemic. It is a epigastric vein.
Say superficial as well as inferior. Okay.
Yes.
Is it commonly seen caput medius?
No, sir.
Why?
Sir, the obliteration of the ligaments.
So most of the time, you see in medicine wards, you may see ascites, but you don't come across caput medius. It is obliterated. Yes. So that is why you don't find caput medius often. Rather, you'll find, unfortunately, esophageal varices giving rise to problems. Okay, right.
Doctor. Yeah, yes, so please continue.
Sorry to interrupt. We have the honor of having Professor Praveen Suryavanshi, sir, also joining us. He was held up in an emergency. Praveen sir is from Aurangabad. Welcome, Praveen sir. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, sir. It's my pleasure.
Welcome, Dr. Praveen. Namaskar.
Namaskar, sir.
Please go ahead.
Dr. Pratik, how do you differentiate caput dilated veins around the umbilicus in a case of portal hypertension from a inferior vena cava obstruction?
Inferior vena cava, there is a dilated vein over the umbilicus as well as the side of the flank, and the sir, flow is from the downwards upwards. While this in a portal hypertension, only the caput medius is seen. Depending on the level of the obstruction, it could be hepatopetal or hepatofugal.
Yeah. Okay. So it is usually towards the leg, that is away from the umbilicus. While in vena cava obstruction, it is towards the head. So that is a differential of caput medius in these two type of pathologies.
But Pratik, where you will examine for the veins to differentiate between the portal and the IVC obstruction?
Sir, around the umbilicus and the flanks.
Which part of the abdomen, lower part or upper part?
Sir, lower part of the abdomen.
Why lower part?
Sir, in IVC obstruction, the vein blood flow is in a vein is from the lower to the towards the umbilicus. While in a portal hypertension, it is away from the umbilicus.
Yeah. So if you examine in the upper abdomen, both will in the same direction.
Yes, sir.
So that is why it has to be always examined in the lower part, not in the upper part.
Upper.
And then you always see for the back of the patient. Okay, if you find the dilated veins there on the back, that is suggestive of IVC obstruction as compared to the portal obstruction. Okay, go ahead.
What are those veins called as, Dr. Pratik, in vena cava obstruction? Why you want to see the lower abdomen there? These are some of the tributaries from the common iliac. Understand? In an attempt for the collaterals, they develop. So maybe anterosacroiliac spine, that level, inferior epigastric veins. Similarly, you have got circumflex veins, etc. They try to join with the axillary vein. So their lateral veins, popularly called as inguinoaxillary vein. Okay? Just remember that word. Inguinoaxillary vein. Go ahead. Hello? Dr. Praveen wants to ask question. Yes, please.
Pratik, especially if you said abdomen is distended, it is not just enough that you are saying that there is no dilated veins in the flank. You must mention what is the whether there is a fullness of the flank on inspection or not. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, the distension can be because of the small bowel, large bowel, or ascites. What is typically known? If it is ascites, there will be associated flank fullness. But if small bowel distension, there won't be any much flank fullness. We must mention in the inspection. Yes, continue.
Think, what are the things you have seen on percussion?
Hepatic span and the splenic span, sir. Any horseshoe dullness and the sifting dullness, sir.
But you have not written anything about the liver span here.
I'm not able to palpate this liver. And as well as, sir, there is a horseshoe dullness is present, sir. That's why, sir, I'm not able to comment on the hepatic span, sir.
No, but did you percuss?
Yes, sir, I tried to percuss, but, sir, lower border dullness is continuous with the, sir, ascites dullness, sir.
And what was the upper border liver dullness?
Sir, in fifth intercostal space, right mid axillary line. Sorry, right mid clavicular line.
And you were able to measure the splenic span?
Yes, sir. Even the splenic dullness is continuous with the ascites dullness. But sir, the lower border, lower edge of the spleen is palpable. So, sir, I marked that point as the lower border, and sir, I percussed that from the left anterior axillary line.
What is the normal site of the splenic dullness?
It is from nine intercostal space in the left at the anterior axillary line. Toward its axis, toward the umbilicus.
On palpation, I think you should always mention the renin angle for any abdomen case. I think you have missed that.
Okay.
Renin angle should be palpated in any case of abdomen, no? So that is also important. That also you have missed. And liver splan should be mentioned. At least upper limit should have been mentioned as that too. Okay.
Yes.
Did you auscultate the abdomen?
Yes, sir.
Go to the auscultation. Next.
No. What you peristalsis. Were interested in the auscultation here?
You have only a peristalsis.
Yes, ma'am. What? Yes, sir. Yes, sir, ma'am. Hmm? There is no Caput medius. I do not auscultate for any hump is present or not.
Venous arm. Oh.
What are the other things you can get on auscultation in a patient with a portal hypertension?
Venous hump in this epigastric region.
Okay, you can hear the venous hump. Yes, what else?
Around the umbilicus also you can get, no?
Yes, sir. Growing hematite sign, sir.
Can you get something over the spleen? Because many of these patients, they have got something that lets the spleen to get attached to the abdominal wall because of?
Photocaval anastomosis, no?
The perisplenitis is there. Okay, so just like you get the pleural rub, similarly, you can have the splenic rub. So when you put your stethoscope there, ask the patient to take deep breath, you can hear that type of the thing exactly like the pleural rub, which is there. Okay, yes. Because the perisplenitis, which is there.
Dr. Pratik, you mentioned in the rectal examination, grade 2 hemorrhoids.
Yes.
What is the difference between grade 2, whatever hemorrhoid you have written, versus rectal varices? What is the difference?
Sir, hemorrhoid is usually present from anal varus distal to the 4 cm, while varices is within this 4 cm. Sir, varices on the pressure disappear, while hemorrhoid is not disappear.
it's not clear. I'm not clear about what did you tell the second half. Hemorrhoids occur where? Hemorrhoids?
Distal to the 4 cm from the anal body.
Say above the level of dentate line. Dentate. Better to say that. Right? In the anal canal, you have got a two parts of the anal canal. What are the two parts of the anal canal? This is a simple question. Anatomical anal canal and surgical anal canal. What is surgical anal canal means?
Below the dentate line, sir.
Above the level of dentate line. That is the place where you get a hemorrhoid. So where do you get rectal varices?
Below the 4 cm, sir.
Below the 4 cm.
Anal wall.
You should be extremely careful while doing a proctoscopy and to brand them as hemorrhoids and don't do hemorrhoidectomy and all here. Okay. They are never like the cherry red, like whatever with the peduncle, with the neck and all the thing they do not have. These are the more or less like a longitudinal column, same like picture you get here also. So you should be very careful not to do hemorrhoidectomy in this type of patients. You should be careful. All right. They have got a very high pressure. Okay. It's very difficult to stop them. So you should be careful while making the statement. Look carefully. Are they really grade 2 hemorrhoid of what you have mentioned or rectal varices? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Pratik, what are the causes of ascites in a case of portal hypertension or liver failure?
Ma'am, either increase hydrostatic pressure or decrease oncotic pressure due to hypoalbuminemia.
Okay. And also because of increased
portal pressure.
Portal pressure. Okay.
Your diagnosis, can you go to the next slide? Yeah.
Why you added only portal hypertension? Ascites. What are the triad to say it is portal hypertension? Ascites, hematemesis, and
splenomegaly.
Why can't you add that?
Ma'am, it is palpatory. Ma'am, it is palpatory finding. Patient present with the ma'am complaint of the ascites and the hematemesis.
It is your diagnosis after examination of the patient only, no?
Yeah, provisional diagnosis includes your after your clinical examination. Splenomegaly is a very important part of this provisional diagnosis, right?
In our institution, see, why you want to mention ascites? You are asked a diagnosis, no?
That's all. No need for all this.
Why you want to mention hematemesis?
Ascites.
So what you should have told, simple, why you don't get into trouble? Portal hypertension. Probably due to alcoholic cirrhosis.
That is the diagnosis.
Yes.
Unnecessarily, don't get into people and all that thing. So, ascites and they are manifestation. Let them ask you what is the triad, like madam has said just now. So, you give them a chance. So, otherwise, that is enough. Okay. Because here, you are not given the cause of portal hypertension. Very, very important.
It is most probably due to alcoholic liver disease.
No, we know. But when you write the diagnosis, ascites and hematemesis is not required. Simple diagnosis in a portal hypertension, secondary to alcoholic cirrhosis. That's all. This is what I feel so.
Sorry, sir, but we prefer to keep all diagnoses because we have to manage patient as a whole. We have to manage his ascites, we have to manage hematemesis. So as a clinician, we must put in our institute, if patient is having associated portal routine hypertension, systemic hypertension, they must mention that also. Because he has to take care of that hypertension also when they are managing patients. So in our institute, we prefer to put everything. As far as I'm concerned, this is perfect.
Okay, sir, no problem. But this is just for information, yes. I said, yes.
I'm just putting my side.
Yes, definitely.
Pratik, what is portal hypertension?
It is increased portal venous pressure more than 10 millimeter of mercury.
What is the normal portal pressure?
It is less than 10 millimeter of mercury. Mostly it is 7 between the range of 7 to 10 millimeter of mercury.
what are the various pressures you can measure in a patient with a portal hypertension apart from, or how will you measure those pressures?
Either wedge hepatic venous pressure and free hepatic venous pressure, we can portal hypertension can be measured between the difference between wedge and free hepatic venous pressure, sir.
Okay.
Gradient.
Right. So what are the various ways to measure the portal pressure?
Sir, either ultrasonographically or the hepatic venous pressure gradient.
You know what is the Planckian occluded portal pressure and what is the hepatic occluded portal pressure?
Sir, if we inflate the balloon, we measure these balloon occluded wedge hepatic pressure, sir. And when we measure the simply without any inflating bottle, it is free hepatic venous pressure.
You know, previously we used to measure the portal pressure by puncturing the spleen and carrying out the splenoportovenography. You know, that is no more done nowadays. So that is in fact one of the best ways to measure the portal pressure. So you have to always measure the indirect way of the pressure. So you can measure the wedge hepatic pressure, or at the time of the operation, you can cannulate one of the veins, tributary, and you can measure the pressure. You can put a clamp over the portal vein and then you can measure the Planckian occluded pressure or the hepatic occluded pressure. That shows whether it is a hepatofugal flow or it's a hepatopetal flow. Okay, so these are the various pressures, and definitely the wedge hepatic pressure, which is there, you measure that. No?
Yes.
Now here, when you are writing the portal hypertension, it is just like saying the patient has got like having a splenomegaly with the ascites and hematemesis. But you have to write down what is the cause of that portal hypertension. That's the one of the most important things.
Okay.
Then only your provisional diagnosis can be complete.
Okay.
So what do you think? What is the cause here?
Sir, alcoholic liver disease.
Alcoholic liver disease is big.
Yes.
Okay. Alcoholic
stetosis,
liver cirrhosis.
Stetosis is also the alcoholic liver disease. Okay. Will that cause the portal hypertension?
No, sir.
So what will cause the portal hypertension?
Alcoholic liver cirrhosis.
The cirrhosis, say that, no?
Yes.
So your diagnosis should be, it's a portal hypertension cause cirrhosis of the liver because of alcoholic origin. Okay.
Yes,
right.
How can I proceed?
Tell what are the various causes of the what are the various inflammatory causes of the portal hypertension?
Hepatitis B, hepatitis C, congenital hepatic fibrosis, schistosomiasis. Other causes, sir.
No, like somebody has got appendicitis. Can you develop the portal hypertension?
No, sir. Sir, perisinusoidal fibrosis must be there, sir. Collagen deposit.
No. Sir has asked a very specific question, and before the advent of these advanced antibiotics, there was very high incidence of portal hypertension due to appendicitis patients, due to portal vein thrombosis.
Okay, the four common causes of the infective cause of the portal hypertension is the omphalitis, you know? That is why, yeah, you always ask, is there an history of umbilical sepsis or not?
Umbilicus.
Yeah, pancreatitis. Pancreatitis is a cause for the portal hypertension. Appendicitis and the diverticulitis. Apart from all those others which you have told, these are the main infective causes for the inflammatory causes for the portal hypertension.
Portal.
Okay. You want to keep any differential diagnosis here?
No, sir. This is straight for portal hypertension with the alcoholic liver cirrhosis.
Tell the other causes of bleed with splenomegaly.
Sir, tropical disease like malaria, kala azar. Sir, malignant condition like leukemia, lymphoma could be present with the splenomegaly with the hematemesis.
So why can't you keep all these things in your differential diagnosis here?
Patient already patient bleed 3 times where he go for a endoscopic therapy and for 1 time sclerotherapy and 2nd time band ligation Sir, it is mostly sir, alcoholic incident. History of 20 years of alcoholism is present.
Right, okay. That's fine, yeah. Absolutely.
Dr. Pratik, when do you suspect a hepatoma developing in this liver clinically?
Usually in a cirrhosis, the liver is shrunken, sir. If the liver is enlarged, we can get any symptoms?
Any symptoms?
Jaundice, sir.
Jaundice is there in cirrhosis also with the liver cell failure. A rapid deterioration of the health suddenly and loss of weight plus palpable liver, right? So these are clue to you whether the patient is developing a malignancy in the cirrhotic liver, right?
Yes.
Okay, right.
What is sinistral portal hypertension?
Sir, it is isolated left-sided portal hypertension, most probably due to either portal vein or splenic vein thrombosis.
What is the common cause for that?
Sir, hypersplenism.
No, that will lead to that, no? But what is the common cause for the...
Arterial coagulation profile. Congenital factor C or factor S deficiency, sir.
Yes, it may be because of thrombophilia that is different, but the pancreatitis, you know?
Yes.
Pancreatitis causes sinistral hypertension. A patient having the pancreatic carcinoma of the body of the pancreas, head of the pancreas can lead to the portal hypertension. Okay, so according to your history and the examination, can you tell what is the child's grade of this patient?
Sir, class B, sir.
Why you say based only the history?
Yes, sir.
Why do you say it is class B?
Ascites, moderate ascites is present. So that right. Is grade 2. Sir, no encephalopathy. One number. Bilirubin. Sir, no ictus present. But it could be. So it could be a sir class either 1 or a 2.
Okay.
Patient bleeding, sir. INR can be altered, sir. So it could be a 2 or a 3. And an albumin, a patient is hypoalbuminemic, sir. So it is 3, sir. So it is between the 6 to 9, sir. It could be a class B CTP score.
Okay. All right. So how you are going to
proceed
with your investigations and the treatment?
I vitally stable the patient.
Patient bleeding?
No, sir. Patient is hypertensive, and sir, he bleed before the 24 hours. But sir, as hematemesis is present, patient could be bleeding from, but like alarm symptoms was there. The patient was bleeding from last 7 days, sir. While the blood investigation come, I start on patient the IV fluid, sir. Calibrated IV fluid, I like to start.
Now, is your patient bleeding at this time?
No, sir.
So, are you going to treat it as an acute case or it is going to be as a follow-up case?
No, sir. It is not acute case, a follow-up case. Sir.
So, how you are going to treat this patient at this time?
First, I like to send the investigation, blood group and save the blood, CBC to look for the hemoglobin, WBC and the platelets, liver profile, total bilirubin.
What will happen to the WBC in this patient? What will happen to the WBC in this patient?
There could be a leukopenia due to hypersplenism.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Right.
What is the triad of hypersplenism?
Splenomegaly with one of the anemia, leukopenia or thrombocytopenia or all of them with bone marrow hyperplasia, which can be reversible with the splenectomy.
No, why hyperplasia? It should be normal cellular bone marrow.
Okay.
Yeah, because bone marrow should be normal. Right? If there is a problem in bone marrow, then aplasia is there, then obviously you are going to have a pancytopenia. And if you can have splenomegaly will be there for the production of more RBC. So a triad includes a normocellular bone marrow. That is, it's not aplastic bone marrow, right? Yes. Along with any of the components of pancytopenia and splenomegaly. Okay, you tell me if some patient undergoes splenectomy, can from the blood picture you can predict that if the patient cannot give you a history of splenectomy? From the peripheral blood spleen picture, can you predict?
Yes, sir. Reticulocytes counts are more, sir, and the immature RBC, sir, altered shaped RBC are there, sir.
What are they called specifically?
Elliptus.
Howell jelly bodies.
Howell jelly bodies, sir.
And Heinz bodies. That is, what are Heinz bodies? They are RBCs with having a denatured hemoglobin, that is defective RBCs which are not cleared by the spleen. So their number increases in the blood circulation, and similarly Howell jelly bodies, that is their DNA, deformed DNA is present, which is usually extruded. So these cells are destroyed and filtered by the spleen. So number of these cells will increase in the blood circulation in a asplenic patient or a post-splenectomy patients.
Okay, after the blood investigation, what are you going to do?
Sir, as soon as possible, sir, endoscopic diagnostic as well as some therapeutic procedures. Sir.
So what you want to see in the endoscopy?
From sir, duodenum, any present of the peptic ulcer is there or not? Is there present of gastritis or not? And at the GE junction, varices or any active bleeding or there or not?
What are the signs of active bleeding that this patient has just bled or probably he may bleed? What are those signs?
Sir, oozing from varices. Present of clot. Present of. Present of any clot present and ulcer is present or not, sir? Overlying mucosa is ulcerated or not?
Very red spots which are there, the blue varices which are there, varices on varices which are there. Okay, all those are the signs for the stigmata of the patient has bled or patient is going to bleed. Both.
Re-bleed, sir, patient. These are signs for patient whether re-bleed or not.
You have done the endoscopy and your gastroenterologist says that this is a grade 2 varices are there. What next?
Sir, I like to go for some band ligation.
But the patient is not bleeding at this time. They say it is just grade 2 varices.
Sir, prophylactic band ligation.
Okay. Prophylactic band.
Pratik, especially in these patients, who are the known case of portal hypertension, who has gone for banding or sclerotherapy in the past. On endoscopy, you must mention whether there is a mucosal fibrosis present or not because of the previous banding. That also you must look for. So when you are doing endoscopy for the first time, when patient has come to you as a first case with portal hypertension, so whatever you mention, it's all right. But if he has been treated previously, so that stigma of previous banding must be looked for in the form of the fibrosis of the mucosa. Second thing that, whenever varices are present, you must mention whether there is a complete column of the esophageal varices. They are present with all these signs of the stigma of the cherry red spots and all that. Or there are the patchy varices in between the area of the previous banding. So in that case, if you want to control these varices, you may not be able to use bands in these varices. So you have to treat these varices, patchy varices, in between areas of the previous banding with the sclerotherapy, because it's not possible to suck them into your barrel. So especially in a treated patient, you must mention these findings. So it shows you know the subject, just then the knowing the answer. Okay.
Pratik, one question from my side. What is secondary prophylaxis?
Secondary prophylaxis is patient is one bleed to prevent the second bleed after the first bleeding episode. It is called a secondary prophylaxis.
No, what do you give? How much you give? And what is the how do you control that?
Sir, we can start pharmacotherapy. Sir, in a form of a propanone, 20 to 160 milligram.
20 milligram? What? How will you monitor that? What does it causes on the cardia, propranolol?
It's a cardiac arrhythmia, sir.
Arrhythmias?
Bradycardia, sir. Bradycardia.
So use proper word. So suppose it goes on up to 40, what will you do then? So you need to monitor, you know, keep it around 60 or so, so that that is one precaution which you need to take. Okay, second question from my side is, this patient's major problem is ascites now, because that's what you mentioned now. How do you control the ascites?
Fluid restriction. Sir, ascitic tap for diagnosis.
What do you mean by fluid restriction? You tell the patient, don't take fluid? What do you mean
salt
by that?
Salt restriction, sir. Use the less salt, sir.
How much? How much?
Maximum 2 grams in a day.
Allowed. Okay. What else?
Ascitic tap for diagnosis. And, further...
Paracentesis. If a lot of difficulties there, diaphragm elevated, breathing difficulty, paracentesis, yes. I just want you to understand what are the various ways in which you can control, including hypoalbuminemia.
Potassium sparing diuretic.
That you should tell. That what is the drug name?
Spironolactone, sir.
What else? Still it is not controlled. What else you can
furosemide, sir.
You have the good facilities, let us say, in your institution. Slowly. What else you can suggest to the patient? What else? Ascites. Few things I think they may ask you. Any shunts you remember?
Yes, sir. We can do, sir. If we don't want to do in this emergency procedure to relieve the ascites, we can go for side-to-side portosystemic.
No. I didn't mean that shunt. I didn't mean that. I asked you specifically.
And
anything else you can still mention tips, and last is transplantation. You need to know all these things is possible in a patient who has got intractable ascites. You know, it's a big problem to treat. Yes, sir. That's all from my side.
Pratik,
what is intractable ascites? Dr. Chinoy just asked you. What is intractable ascites?
Ascites which cannot, which recurrent after the medical line of treatment, sir.
So what is that? How much is the maximum tolerated dose which can be given and still it is not controlled?
40 milligrams, sir, BD, sir.
No. If a patient is on the salt restricted diet and the patient has been given 80 milligrams of furosemide and 400 milligrams of spironolactone, and still, if the ascites is not controlled, that is called as the intractable ascites. And in the intractable ascites, you can go for all those things. The tips can be done. You can do the peritoneovenous shunts. You can do the side-to-side portacable shunts, or you can go for the transplantation. Can you name certain peritoneovenous shunts which are there?
Levini or Denver shunts.
Levini and Denver shunts. Yeah, Dr. Shirazi was asking something. Yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Pratik, like in the beta receptor antagonist non-responders, as I said, as intractable ascites. But is the new recent drug that is used in conservative management if the patient is not meant for TIPS or liver transplant? That is now more commonly used drug, and it is more effective in reducing the hepatic venous pressure gradient because it has alpha receptor antagonist activity also. What is that drug? Carvedilol. Okay, carvedilol is a specific drug which is now used for, it is a better drug than propranolol, and especially for propranolol non-responders. Okay.
Pratik, you mentioned about the prophylaxis. So, what is there a role of primary prophylaxis in this patient?
Yes, sir.
When will you start primary prophylaxis? What is primary prophylaxis and secondary?
Primary patient is never bleed, we prevent the first bleed, which is primary prophylaxis, and secondary prophylaxis, patient is once bleed, and to prevent the re-bleeding, we do secondary prophylaxis.
Well, when we will start primary prophylaxis, what is the role of?
Great. Sir, in a cirrhosis, it is if KPA is sir more than 20, sir. Then we can start, sir, a primary profile access.
But if you're not able to measure the pressure, then.
Yeah, what are the clinical markers based on which you start a primary prophylaxis? Because it is not indicated even in small varices. You don't start the primary prophylaxis. Sir is asking this question.
Okay. So if you don't, so you must start it only when there are the danger signs, what we mentioned about the cherry red spots and veins on vein.
Yeah.
Patient is having rare blood group. If this patient bleeds, we will not able to resuscitate them efficiently.
Mm.
Or patient is staying away from the institute where he will reach within half an hour for the resuscitation. Suppose patient is staying in the remote area. For him to reach the primary health center, if it takes one more than an hour or so. So these are the only very few subset of patient where we can stop the primary prophylaxis.
Yeah. Two more points are that a child class C cirrhosis. If child C class C is there, and the large and moderate size varices, that is more than 5 millimeter in size, then you can start primary prophylaxis. Other indications are, I have already told that patient is of a rare blood group and all these things.
So, but the risk, what risk you will explain to the patient when you start primary primary prophylaxis?
Sir, there complications of this is endoscopic therapy like esophagitis, infection, ulceration, or perforation.
And other than there will be increase in ascites.
Ascites, yes.
The patient which otherwise asymptomatic may become symptomatic once you block these varices. Okay, so that has to be explained and patient needs to be monitored.
What is the percentage risk reduction, Dr. Pratik, after starting the beta blockers?
Sir, 75%. Sir.
No. It's not. It's 15-30% risk reduction of the bleeding if you start a primary prophylaxis, right?
See, how will you manage this patient if they comes with bleeding?
Sir, if patient come with the bleeding, first, sir, I sent blood investigation, blood group and save the blood, all the other investigation. Start, sir, colloid, IV colloid, sir. As the CBC come, if, sir, RBC is down, RBC, hemoglobin is less than 8%, 8 gram per deciliter, I start patient blood transfusion, and then start the pharmacotherapy.
Have you managed yourself anytime patients?
Yes, sir.
With portal hypertension?
Yes, sir.
They bleed very massively. You don't get time to get the CBC report. They are bleeding in front of you.
Sir, pharmacotherapy, vitamin K, sir, and telepacing, I said I will start, sir. 2 gram, sir, IV stage, sir. And then 2 gram QI.
Before that, most important thing, you are not.
Sir, Sangston black molar tube, sir.
And no, that is last. Blood for the hemoglobin, you must send blood immediately for the grouping
cross-match.
That is most important thing. If you don't have hemoglobin, don't bother. But you must have blood to your disposal to resuscitate this patient effectively. Okay, because you should not just aim at resuscitating this patient with the crystalloids or colloids, because ultimately this patient end up in bleeding more if you just resuscitate with crystalline colloids. And simultaneously, you must send for the coagulation profile and all that. Okay, so what should be your aim of resuscitating this patient? How much fluid you will push in?
Sir, 2 liters, sir.
Why?
Sir, as patient already have, sir, ascites, sir, if we give more fluid, sir, it will be actually ending in the increase hypostatic pressure, which lead to the more increase in the ascites.
We are not worried of ascites at this stage. We are worried about the life. If the patient comes with massive bleeding, we have to save his life first.
Sir, at that time, sir, blood group is blood group cross blood is ready, sir. So I start sir massive blood transfusion protocol. Sir.
Now, what is your target blood pressure?
Exactly. That's what.
The question is, sir is asking, what is your target blood pressure?
Sir, systolic 90 millimeter of mercury, sir.
No. Mean arterial pressure should be 70. That should be the target. I know, while resuscitating this patient, enthusiastically, we should not
raise the blood.
Yeah. To the 120/80.
Systolic blood pressure is target is 80 millimeter of mercury. In any case of bleeding, even in trauma bleeding, also residents make a mistake of infusing the fluids, transfusing the blood, trying to maintain it to 120 levels. This is the normal blood pressure. No, you have to keep the blood pressure only 80 systole because it is sufficient to supply the coronary arteries, your brain, and kidneys. So this is the requirement. The more you raise the blood pressure, the more it is going to bleed. So target blood pressure is 80 millimeter of mercury, systolic blood pressure.
You recommend mean arterial pressure should be 70.
Yeah, that is right.
So that should be your target. So over enthusiastically, we should not unnecessarily push the crystallites. So with crystallites, bloods become more thin. And so there are the less chances of blood, clot formation and the blood bleeding stopping by itself. Okay. So preferably you must replace blood with blood. If blood is not available, until you are waiting for the blood to come, you can replace it with the crystallite or colloids.
Yes.
But when blood is available, please replace it with blood only.
Along with blood, I think you should add fresh frozen plasma because the coagulopathy is also going to be there. So you should add more of blood, fresh blood and FFP. That should be the most important resuscitation measure.